Good, so before we go into the new material, let me just summarize on two slides what we did yesterday. So in a short summary. So first I gave you a little motivation, a little overview about random Schrödinger operators, disordered quantum systems, about Anderson transition. This was an indication that random matrices as a theory, it's useful not just in probability theory, but also it has some relevance in physics as well. And then let me remind you that the main goal is to prove the local law, and we are using the resolvent method, which means the following, written here, I just wrote it up in for Wigner type matrices. The local law means that you want to understand the resolvent, G was the 1 over H minus Z, the resolvent of the random matrix, and GII refers to the II's diagonal matrix element. So we'd like to understand this random quantity, and this random quantity turns out to be a close to a deterministic number called MI, and closeness means that there is an explicit bound in terms of 1 over n times imaginary part of Z. So always think in such a way that the relevant regime is when the imaginary part of Z is very small. That's the regime where the Stieltjes transform or the resolvent carries a very valuable information about the local distribution of the eigenvalues. So the imaginary part Z is always very small. N is, of course, n is the size of the matrix. That's always very big. And we also know that the imaginary part of Z cannot be too small. It has to be above 1 over n. Otherwise, the resolvent will become truly fluctuating, and you cannot hope such a low of large number type results. And this bound exactly reflects that because the control is in terms of 1 over square root of n and imaginary part Z. So as long as the imaginary part of Z is much bigger than 1 over n, then this is useful. Then this error term is it low of 1. Okay, and now, so this is the goal, and now of course we have to figure out what MI is. And MI is the solution of our quadratic vector equation, so let me just write it up here. 1 over MI equals Z plus SMI. So it's a vector equation in terms of, so the unknown is a big vector, M, which has n components. With the side condition that the imaginary part of MI is always positive, and of course Z, which we usually write as E plus I eta, this is also in the upper half plane, so this is the starting point. And this equation we will see today, that this equation has a unique solution under this additional constraint, and that unique solution is that defines the MI, and the GII is close to that MI, that's what the local law says. And once you have that, once you know how the diagonal elements behave, then of course you will know how the trace behaves. You just sum up the diagonal elements, normalize it, so the trace will become, let me write it up maybe. So if you take the imaginary part of M, the summation of imaginary part of MI, and normalize it, then I also will denote it by the average I denoted by this bracket, then this guy will be the Stieltjes transform of the so-called self-consistent density of states of a measure, and this is the measure whose pictures you have seen, I mean, on the various pictures. So for example, in case of the Wigner matrices, this is just a semicircle, but in general it's something else. Okay, so this is the connection between the resolvent and the solution of the self-consistent equation. There's Dyson, we also call it Dyson equation. And the message was that even if you are interested only in the density, in other words, you are just interested in the average of this imaginary part of M's, which is just a scalar function, there is no known simple equation for the a closed equation for this quantity. You have to go through the equation, through this equation of n variables, which we call vector equation because the unknown object is a vector. You have to solve this vector equation, and only from the solution you compute its average, and that gives you the Stieltjes transform of the measure. But of course, I mean, the local law carries much more information, and this information are needed also for universality. It carries much more information, not just the information on the density itself. Okay. And then, this is still yesterday, so we mentioned that there are two steps in the proof of the local law. One of them, what we call the derivation of the corresponding equation, to see how such an equation emerges if you start from the resolvent. So here, let me just call GI, little GI, the, for simplicity, the resolvent diagonal matrix element of the resolvent. And then we have to prove, and that we discussed last time, we have to prove that this GI satisfies an equation which is reminiscent to our QVE, our quadratic vector equation, but it has an error term, DI, and this error term carries, it turns out to be small, it carries many many different terms. The most important term on it is a large deviation, it's a fluctuation estimate on some quadratic functional of an independent vector of random variables. So this we discussed last time, and also in exercise Torben discussed it, how to estimate this thing. And then it turns out that this DI with some very high probability behaves like this 1 over square root of n eta, exactly the same precision what here you want to reach. I also should have mentioned, I said it yesterday, but all these bounds are, this little wiggle line is understood with a little grain of salt. So first of all, these bounds are always understood with very high probabilities and not almost sure bounds, because sometimes the resolvent with very small probability can behave completely crazily. And also there's a little tolerance here. So typically, there's, instead of this one, there should be a factor which grows slowly with n. For simplicity in the notes, you have n to the epsilon here for any positive epsilon, but you can have also some log power. But I neglect these subtleties, so I will compress all these things into this notation, which also includes the high probability sense. Okay, so back here, so the D is this error term coming from large deviation bound that's also understood in that sense, so it's with high probability and with an additional factor of n to the epsilon. Okay, so we have this equation. So this equation is very close to the our QVE, the deterministic equation. And then the second step is that now you want to compare the solution of these two equations. You want to compare the unperturbed, we think of that equation as a perturbation of the unperturbed deterministic equation for MI. And then you would like to understand that what happens to this equation, what happens to the solution of this equation if you perturb it by some small object. It's a random object, but for that second part of the analysis, it doesn't matter whether D is random or not. What matters is that it's a small quantity, small vector actually. And then you want to conclude that then the solution is, that this equation is stable under small perturbation. So in other words, then the solution in some appropriate norm, which in that case is just the maximum norm, will be bounded by the G minus M difference, will be bounded by the D, by the perturbation. Okay, so that's the goal. And as the step number one we discussed last time, this relied on the Schur complement formula and also some large deviation bound. And then step two comes today when we discuss the stability and various properties of this QVE. Okay, so that's what we had more or less last time. Is there any question? It's early in the morning, yes.
So when you say that these quantities have to be bounded below something with high probability, in what sense do you mean that?
Well, high probability means, so for example, let me write up what I mean by this DI. What I write here, it really means the following in my language, that you take the probability that this DI is bigger than, now you have the n eta, but as I said, I want to have for the little a big factor here, not too big, but a factor which goes to infinity, so I can just put an n to the epsilon, that the probability that this guy is much bigger than this 1 over n eta, this is very small, so typically it's n to the 1 over n to the d. And this is understood in such a way that this holds for every epsilon m d positive, and there is a constant here if you want to be absolutely precise. So for every epsilon m d, there exists a constant c. So this constant depends on epsilon and d. So that this holds for every n. So that's what I mean by high probability bound. And here, of course, you should think in such a way that epsilon is tiny, so arbitrary small number, and d is an arbitrary big number. Okay, that's when the estimate is useful. Okay, so this tells you that you have an arbitrary, this probability has an arbitrary polynomial tail. The precise kind, I mean, you can use any epsilon, any delta. If you put some more, this kind of bound depends on how strong moment conditions you assume on the random variables, on the initial matrix elements. If you assume a bit more, then you also can get some exponential, sub-exponential decay here. But this is not so important for us. The 1 over n to the d is, as a probability bound, is already very, very strong. So everything works with that. Okay, any other question? Okay, good. So now let me come to the analysis of this QV. So today we will work with that equation. There will be no randomness today. I already motivated that the only issue, the main issue, is to understand various properties of that equation. Now, here's just a remark which I'm not going to pursue here, but actually the equation can have an additional term here. There's a term, a vector A, which I could insert it into that. This is also part of the data. And we can do most of the analysis also if you have an A here. The we call it external source. The role of the A comes in if your original random matrix does not have centered entries. So I said that now we discuss always the case when the matrix elements have zero expectation, but if you don't have zero expectation, you can also include it into our analysis. That's how you include it. But I'm not going to discuss it today. I just put it in once. Okay. Now the important data is the matrix S. So there is this S matrix, which remember that was given by the variance of the matrix elements Hij. By nature, this is, of course, because H is a Hermitian matrix, this Sij is naturally symmetric. So S equals T, of course. This is a basic standing assumption. And the other standing assumption is that the matrix elements of Sij are positive or non-negative. These are also obviously in our application. But from now on, we will just look at this equation coming out of nowhere. We don't have to remember that it comes from a random matrix, as long as these conditions are satisfied. So we think of S as a symmetric matrix with non-negative entries, and also we assume some upper bound on that. So it's equivalent to an upper bound on the variances. Okay. So now let me introduce a notation here, which you may find confusing, but it's a very useful notation. The notation is that I don't want to write too many indices. I will use the vector notation. So in particular, this equation I would like to write in such a way that it's 1 over minus 1 over m equals z plus m, z plus sm, and I cannot really produce boldface on the blackboard, so these are understood in boldface. So it's a whole vector. Maybe let me underline that refers to the boldface. So I will write the QV in this compact form. But of course, this compact form should be understood. I mean, on that side, you know what it means, because M is a vector and S is a matrix acting on a vector, that you know what it is. But 1 over M looks a little bit strange, because M is a vector. Now you take the reciprocal of a vector. This is not quite allowed, except that here I'm defining the reciprocal of a vector just entry-wise. So this is for simplicity. And similarly, more general, if I write a function of a vector, then I understand it in such a way that the outcome is a vector, and each component is just F applied to that vector. And I will use a similar thing for products. So I will, a few times you will see a multiplication of two vectors, U times V. It's an ad hoc notation. This is not the dot product. The outcome is a vector, which is just the entry-wise multiplying vectors. And similarly, if I write somewhere that U is smaller than V, then it's understood entry-wise. Okay, so it's just a shortening the notation. Okay, so the equation up here is already written in this simplified shortened form. Now, Let me start with discussing a little bit the existence and the uniqueness of the solution of this equation. I will not do it in full detail. I'll just, yeah? No, I mean exactly in that way. So in particular, you may not be able to compare any two vectors. So this is exactly what it says. For every I, ui has to be smaller than vi. And if the u1 is smaller than v1, but the u2 is bigger than v2, then I cannot compare them. No, these are for real numbers, of course. Yeah, I mean, you are right, it's a bit misleading. So, of course, the first one is for any complex number, the second one is only for real numbers, yes. Okay, any other questions? Good. So let me discuss a little bit the existence and uniqueness of this equation. This is sort of a folklore theorem, and even I'm not sure if we could find the first mentioning of that. But let me just say how it goes. So the statement is that this equation, this is what I call the QV, it's always understood that with the side condition that M is on the upper half plane, so component-wise is in the upper half plane. And actually sometimes you think of it in such a way that Z is a parameter. Of course the solution M depends on this parameter. And sometimes you think of it in such a way that M is a function of Z. So you solve it not just for every fixed Z, but you solve it as a function of Z. So you can do. Once you establish that there is a unique solution, you can. It makes sense to talk about the Z, the MZ as a function of Z. Okay, and the statement is that this has a unique solution, there exists a unique solution, and also it has a representation, namely, it's no wonder that everything is called M, namely, it's a Stieltjes transform of somebody, in other words, there is a probability measure, a unique probability measure, the real line, so that this mi, for every I, there is such a measure, this mi is the Stieltjes transform of that measure. Okay? I mean, eventually we know that this mi is supposed to approximate a resolvent, and the resolvent itself is a Stieltjes transform of somebody, so it's natural that mi is also a Stieltjes transform of somebody. Okay, and we also have few properties of this measure, which I didn't put on this slide. You can find in the notes. Okay, so now how does one prove something like that? It's a fixed point argument. It's the easiest. And basically, you do it in the most brutal, most natural way. You write this equation as a fixed point equation, so you take the reciprocal and minus, so you write the equation in such a way that m equals minus 1 over z plus sm. Notice that this convention, notation convention is used all the time. Here, this is z plus sm is a vector. Absolutely precisely, of course, z s times m is a vector, and then z is just a scalar, but by this notation I mean that it's z times the 1, 1, 1, 1 vector, so I add z to every component of it. And then I take the reciprocal of that vector, as we discussed, in an entry-wise form. Okay, so this object here is an element of Hn. It's a vector. H is the upper half plane. This was somewhere, but... just put it here. Okay, so you write it as a fixed point equation, then you set up the usual fixed point procedure. So you define the map, which is exactly this map, and then which is exactly a map on the right hand side, and then the fixed point of that map is the solution. Okay, so now you would like to set up a fixed point argument, and typically there are two things about the fixed point argument to establish. One of them is that you have to find a compact set which is mapped into itself. That's one ingredient, which I didn't work out. I didn't write up explicitly. It's a set of, which maybe in the next transparency it will be there. So it's a big compact set appropriately chosen. And then the more important thing that you have to find a good metric in which this is a contraction. Okay, so that's how fixed point argument goes. And here is the right metric. Don't get scared. It's a fairly natural metric. So first of all, you define the you go back to the hyperbolic metric on E, which is written like that somewhere. So here's the formula. So the two points in the upper half plane, zeta and omega, the distance of zeta and omega is given like zeta minus omega squared divided by the imaginary parts. That's a distance. This is related to the hyperbolic metric, those who like that. So it's capital D here, something is missing here. I think I, I missed the hyperbolic metric. So the 2 times cosine hyperbolic times the hyperbolic metric minus 1. So this capital D is basically the hyperbolic metric, the standard hyperbolic metric on the upper half plane. So this is our metric. We have to check various things that it's really a nice metric and so on. And then this is a metric between 2 elements of the upper half plane, and then you take the maximum of that coordinate-wise, because eventually you want to compare, you have to set up something in H to the N, so you want to set up a metric in the on vectors, but then you take just the supremum of that. Okay? And that's it. And then here's the set. There's a set in which you, there's a big set which is basically a set of that type. You want to be a little bit away from the real axis, and then you don't want to go out to infinity. So you take a big set like that, and then you work on that. Okay, so the precise formula is not that important. That there is such a set, and especially there is a metric. And now you have to. You would like to check that this is a contraction, so you have to check that this map here, which is called phi in the previous transparency. Sorry, so there is this map phi, which contains composition of some standard, some simple operations. You can set up this map in such a way that you have a linear on the U. You act by a linear. Operate by a matrix multiplication, it's a linear transformation, plus an affine transformation, plus you shift it, and then you take the reciprocal. Now you can follow all these three operations. You can follow through on the matrix, so you can see how the contraction emerges, and then you can prove a type of contraction that the d phi of u phi of v is smaller than d of uv. Okay, so this requires a calculation, and phi is this map here. This guy is phi of m. So this requires a calculation, not completely trivial, using various properties of the upper half plane. But the operations that are used here, linear transformation, taking the reciprocal, and so on, these are the typical transformations which behave very well under the hyperbolic metric, so it's believable. I don't claim that you should see it through immediately, but it's believable that such a contraction works for a map of that type. Okay, and then once you establish the contraction, then you can start from anything basically. So for example, you can start from the constant function, the constant vector, which is 1 1 1 1 everywhere, it's the upper half plane, so it's I everywhere, and then you run the iteration, and then it will end up with the solution. Okay, and then in that way you get a map, you get a solution, but also you can think of it in such a way that you solve it, and this z here indicates that a little bit secretly. You can also think in such a way that you solve it not just for a fixed z in the space of Hn, but you think of it as a function of z. So instead of m, you think of it as m of z. So m is a vector, and m of z is now a vector valued function. So you can set up a space, and this already set it up in that space. You can set up a space. And a metric. Not just for vectors, but vector-valued functions of the upper half plane, and then you have to use a little bit analytic theory. So you find that along this operation keeps analyticity. So you can find that when you do this iteration, when you are not just getting the solution for every z of the equation, but you also get that this solution is analytic in z. So it turns out that because every iterator is analytic, and there is some standard compactness result in analytic functions, which tells you that the limit of analytic of or the limit sufficiently strong limit of pointwise analytic functions is analytic. So you get an analytic function on the upper half plane. Remember, because you want to check not just the uniqueness, but we also want to check that it's a Sirtias transform of somebody. And remember that there was a characterization of the Sirtias transform. Something is a Sirtias transform if it's an analytic function on the upper half plane. That's why we would like to check analyticity. And then there was another condition. There was a normalization condition, this I eta. If you go out in the imaginary axis to infinity, then anything, any Sirtias transform has to have a definite behavior in that direction. And this you can check basically directly from the equation. Let me not go through it. Okay, and in particular, you also get a bonus estimate for the solution. So let me just erase this. So you also get once you establish that this is a that this is an analytic function, that this is a Sirtias transform, then you also get that the M in supremum norm is bounded by 1/8, as any Sirtias transform does that. So at least we have some upper bound, some a priori bound on the boundedness of the solution. Okay, so these are the things that you get out of basically from nowhere, or just from standard nonsense. And now the goal would be to improve such an estimate. Because remember that we are interested in the situation eta is small, actually it goes to zero. So an estimate which is of order 1/8 is not particularly useful for the analysis, so we'd like to improve it. So the goal, improve it, you would like to get, of course you may need some other conditions on the conditions here in terms of S, of course. You would like to get conditions which tell you that this M, the solution is an order one object. And this is what we will work on next. So that's the next chapter, that we would like to get bounds on the solution. And immediate, so let me introduce these two norms. We will work in two different norms. There's the L2 norm, and there's the L infinity norm. The L infinity norm is clear. This I already used it here. It's just the supremum of the, or maximum of each entry. And the L2 norm is also the usual L2 norm, except that I normalize everything by 1/n. I like to think of this summation over the indices as a probability measure. So in this way, various Hölder inequalities and so on will become simpler. Okay, so this is the L2 norm. And then we will have three types of bounds. The first bound will be an L2 bound, which is with some additional condition on S, which will be useful in the bulk. It should be useful in the regime where you have L. So bulk means the regime where this regime here, when you are strictly away from the edge inside, well inside the support of rho. So this is the bulk. Okay, so there will be a bound of that type, which is an L2 bound on the solution. Bound always means that the bound will not be that bad. It will not be a 1/8 bound, it will be an order one bound. Okay, so this will be one bound. This will require a bound, at least in the simplest case, will require a condition, the Sij. Remember, the Sij, the variance of the matrix elements, if you are in a mean field situation, then typical size of the variance is of order 1/n. So here we will assume that, but we will assume it also as a lower bound, not just an upper bound. One can do a bit weaker conditions as well, but for simplicity, I will do that. This will be one type of bound. There will be another type of bound, which we call the unconditional L2 bound. This will unconditional means that it doesn't use anything about the S operator, about the S matrix, apart from these two properties, that it's symmetric and positive entries. There will be such a bound, and this bound is very useful because it's a robust bound, but on the other hand, this will not work at zero. And somehow zero is a special point of this equation. Zero means that z equals zero, the spectral parameter. And then there will be L infinity bound, so that will be really the improvement of that bound in supremum norm. L infinity bound of order one, but for that we need an additional condition, some kind of regularity condition on S. So these are the three types of bounds, and now in the next slide I will discuss all of them. So this is a bit more precise formula of this bound. So this will be the L2 bound, which is useful in the bulk, or actually you will see that it's also useful when you are far away from the spectrum at all. And here I assume that the S's are, the matrix elements are of order 1, or of order 1 over n, so Sij over date Sxy is 1 over n. So this notation means that there is a lower bound and a matching, a lower and a matching upper bound, so it really means that, just write it up once. So this really means that the Sij is smaller than C over n and bigger than or equal to C over n for some positive constants. Fixed positive constants. Of course, all these constants, n is our big parameter, so all these constants should be independent of n. Okay? So in particular, if you have such a property, then you can easily see that the S operator, when it acts on positive vectors, of course, S has a, if V is positive, I mean entry-wise positive or non-negative, then S has non-negative elements, so S times V is also a positive or non-negative vector. And under this condition, it's easy to see that this basically tells you that the SV, it's a vector, and every element of the SV is comparable with some C times the average of V, and there's a similar lower bound with another constant C. So S is a very nice averaging, it acts like an averaging operator. So this is a useful property. It's a quite strong property, we can relax it quite substantially, but I don't want to discuss it here. And now then under these conditions, you get an L2 bound, you can improve the bound, there's no 1 over 8, you get an order 1 L2 bound. And moreover, you can get a bound, this other norm, the unnoticed norm, the unmarked norm is always the L infinity bound, the supremum bound. You can get a supremum bound, which is an order one bound, as long as you are either in the bulk, rho is this density, or there's another option that you are far away from the bulk, far away from the spectrum. So the spectrum looks far away from the support of rho. So the support of rho is a compact set. This is one of the results which I didn't state. And then there is a regime when you are inside the bulk. That's good, because then you can estimate things in terms of 1 over rho. And then there is a regime when you are far away from the bulk. So this is the outside regime, which is also good. Then you can use the distance to the support. And then there is always a regime which is the most critical one, what happens near the edge. And this regime I'm not going to discuss. That's a long story, and this is actually the analysis what you need to do if you really want to get these nice pictures. When I said that we have an analysis, we have an understanding what kind of singularities the rho can have, then we have to analyze everything up to the edge precisely, but I'm not going to discuss that. So it will be, everything will be basically in the bulk. So in that situation, you will have an L infinity bound on the solution, and also you will find that the imaginary part of M is an important quantity. This is the quantity which gives you the density. The imaginary part of M is comparable with rho. Rho is the average of the, it's written here, rho is the average of the imaginary part of M. So it's entry-wise comparable with its average, at least as a lower bound, and also as an upper bound, but you need an additional factor, which is the L infinity norm of the M. So the lower bound is very good. The upper bound is the upper bound is also good as long as you are in the bulk. So as long as you have the M being bounded by order one. But once you start going near to the edge, then all these things start deteriorating, especially this bound starts deteriorating, then you have to do